pray. Father, thank you for this beautiful morning. In the name of Jesus Christ, rebuke and bind every foul, wicked, evil spirit. We command you to go from here right now in Jesus' name, that your word may have free course in the midst of us. Thank you, Lord, you've given us the promise that even if it's sick, you and dwell in your house. Lord, we got to be able to marvel at your beauty and receive your guidance. And even in the times of great adversities, you will keep and treasure us in your shelter, and you will set us on high on a rock that is out of the reach of all those adversities. In Jesus' precious name, and all the people say, amen. Now, today I want to share with you on how you can do great exploits. Remember, this series is on kingdom inheritance. That God has a great destiny, unique destiny for you. I want to share with you how you could be able to do great exploits when your heart is single-minded. How many of us know that we are the cream of God's creation? You know that? When God created the elephant and the donkey and the magnificent mountains at the Swiss Alps. How many have been to Switzerland and see the Swiss Alps? It is magnificent. God says, okay, good. But God made you, he said, very good. Remember the astounding distinction we have, comparison to the animals and the donkeys and the elephant? He said, God gave us a great brain. God gave us a soul, God gave us a spirit. And this is what the Bible describes as the heart of us. It's very unique. But our heart and our mind and our thinking and our feeling is like a computer. You may have the best hardware, but if your software is infected with viruses, your computer is not going to function right. You're going to slow down. Some of the files are going to be corrupted. And that computer is not going to be able to fulfill the destiny that the computer is created to fulfill. The same way, Hamra must know, sometimes our heart, our mind, our feeling, the inner being is infected with all kinds of viruses. Pastor, I just am not able to do this. I will never be amount to anything. I am not attractive. I'm not this, I'm not that, I don't have the connection, I don't have the ability, I don't have the skills. Pastor, I never overcome this particular habit, I'll never be able to overcome that debt, the way that I'm earning the income, it's going to take me 100 years before I pay all my debts. I must know, that is a viral attack in your heart. And the point is that when your thinking is limited, your life is going to be limited. You cannot go on all the time, thinking negative, talking negative, feeling negative, and thinking you can do great exploits. Remember the 2 million of them giving you the great amount of amazing promises, amazing destiny God has promised them, the 2 million people, just about on the verge of entering the promised land. All of them, except Joshua and Caleb, didn't make it. Because why? They have their mind infected with viruses. They say, we are just but grasshoppers, and they were the giants in the land. In other words, you cannot keep on talking, feeling negative, and expect to do great exploits. This is why Jesus Christ said in Matthew 5, verse 6,
blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God.
What do you mean by that word pure? Now, to be pure, it does not mean to be perfect. None of us know, none of us is perfect, including your pastor. To be pure means single-minded. It means to be unpolluted. The Greek word is unsoiled, unalloyed, unpolluted. It's being single-minded. When your heart is single-minded, it says here, blessed are the pure in heart. Your heart, of course, refers to your thinking, your feeling, the inner self. When your heart is pure, you're going to be able to see God. Never see God is absolutely fantastic. In original Greek, it does not mean merely to see a vision. I don't want to see a vision, I'm scared of God, and I don't want to see him. No, it's talking about seeing, but in terms of knowing. That word see means also to enjoy God. In other words, when your heart is single-minded, and your heart is not polluted with viruses, you're going to be able to know God and enjoy God. And the reason why we need to see God is because the Bible says, the people that know their God shall do great exploits. And the key to doing great things in life is going to have our mind and our heart singer. All right, you're going to be able to see Him as He really is. Oh, Pastor, talk about God. I actually don't really believe in God. You know, this little girl came to the mother and said, Mom, how did we come about? Mom said, well, God one day created Adam and Eve, and there we are. All of us are seeds of Abraham and seeds of Adam. So the little girl went over to Daddy and said, Dad, how did we come about? Dad said, oh, no, actually, one day there was a monkey. And after millions of years, through the natural selection and evolution, there we are, descendants of that particular monkey. And the little girl was a little bit confused, right? Because, Mom, you say we come from God, and then Dad say we come from the monkey? And Mom said, there's no problem, don't be confused. Your dad is describing his side of the line. I'm talking about my side. I remember that it takes more faith to be an atheist. How many believe when I tell you that the Oxford Dictionary come about through an explosion in a printing store? You said it passes crazy, because there's no chance. It takes one in a billion for the Oxford Dictionary to come out of an explosion. The same way, it's all. This animal called a monkey, after millions of years, natural selection by natural choice and the survival of the fittest, after millions of years, somehow, human being, an amazing master, greatest computing human being can ever make. This amazing being is produced by chance. Hey, it takes more faith to be an atheist than to believe in evolution. How many say amen to that? So, one of the most interesting things, that God never tried to prove He's there. One of the most astounding verses in the entire Bible is just one sentence that solved the problem of creation. Scientists, evolutionists try to, they have tons of books to produce a hypothesis, not even a theory. Evolution is not even a theory, it's a hypothesis. And there are tons and volumes of books to do it. God settled it in one sentence. In all its majesty, it simply says in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning, God created. Finish. That is one of the most majestic verses in the entire Bible. In the beginning, God. And the key for us is to know Him. The more we know Him as He really is, you find that you're going to be able to do great exploits. Today, we want to see on how do we really know Him. The key to know Him, see Him, and enjoy Him, all right, is our heart got to be pure. Christ said, blessed, happy. The word, remember, blessed means happy. Happy when your heart is pure, when your heart is single-minded, when your heart is unpolluted, infected by viruses, you're going to be able to see God and do great exploits. Now, today I want to just focus on one aspect of the heart, which is our thinking. Because I'm reminded of the greatest spiritual warfare can ever fight is not wrestling with the demon, the possessed guy running the floor, foaming. Of course, that is part of spiritual warfare. The greatest war you can ever face every day of your life is right here. Because Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4.
For the weapons of our warfare are not of the flesh, but divinely powerful for the destruction of fortresses.
Paul said you've got to take every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, because that's the greatest war. Why? Because right believing leads to right living. I said it time and again, that every self-defeated behavior is because of a lie that we believe in. So we're going to see God and do great exploit and enjoy Him. Your heart must be pure. Doesn't mean perfect, it means to be single-minded. It means to be unpolluted by viruses, our focus, single-mindedly, number one, on the promises of God, number two, on His greatness, number three, on His goodness. Very simple message today, huh? Single-minded, focus on His promises. Number two, on His greatness. Number three, on His goodness. Number one, let your heart be single-minded on His promises, not the problems. Now, why? The God wants us to focus on His promises, not on the problem. The reason is because, Abraham must know, when we focus on our problem, we magnify the problem. How many can see what I'm holding in my hand? Just a little 50-cent coin. Those of you at the gallery and above and the overflow, you probably can't see this 50-cent coin. But do you know that this 50-cent coin can actually blind the sun. They close my eye, I can literally close the shining sun. So none of your problem, no matter how big or small, when you look at it, when you begin to focus on it, actually, it can actually magnify your problems to the extent that you can't see what God wants you to see. But when you focus and put your heart focus on the promises of God, you see that faith is going to arise. Look at the story of Abraham, for example. Remember, God gave an amazing promise, but it was already 100 years old and he's still not having any baby. And Sarah was 90 years old. How did he fulfill God's destiny? Look at Romans chapter 4, verse 19.
And not being weak in faith, Abraham did not consider his own body already dead, and the deadness of Sarah's womb.
Wow! What did Abraham do? Abraham did not consider his own body. He didn't do a Google search on the chances of a man age 100 producing a baby. He did a Google search, a safari search, whether a lady at age 90 can produce a baby. The Bible says he considered not his physical condition. What did he condition? Verse 20.
He did not waver at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strengthened in faith, giving glory to
what
God.
What did he do? He didn't waver. His consideration, not his own body, but is on the promises of God. What is the result? Verse 21.
And being fully convinced that what he had promised, he was also able to perform.
Well, as we focus on the promises of God, not his own physical condition, not the natural, he was fully persuaded. Because his focus is upon the promises. His heart, Abraham's heart. Now, by no means Abraham was perfect. I can tell a lot of story about Abraham's imperfection. But his heart is pure. He's single-minded. He is not polluted. His focus is upon the promises of God. It's a key thing for us to see breakthroughs, great exploits in our life, that in the midst of whatever challenges that we may be facing, keep our heart single-mindedly focused on the promises of God. Maybe you hear all kind of reports about an economic situation, we're entering into the season of economic insecurity. Now, instead of considering the situation, oh, Pastor, in the light of the economic situation, I don't think I'm going to get my promotion. Oh, Pastor, in the light of the economic situation, I don't think I'm going to be able to send my children to university. Oh, Pastor, in the light of the economic situation, I think it'll be about 250 years before I paid off all my debts. What happened is that you have an attack, a viral infection in your thinking. Get rid of that and focus on his promises. My God will supply all my needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. And he takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servants. Look at Deuteronomy 28 verse 11.
God will lavish you with good things, children from your womb, offspring from your animals, and crops from your land, the land that God promised your ancestors that he would give you.
Wow, that's an amazing, astounding promise. God said he will lavish you with good things. Oh, Pastor, in the light of the present circumstances, difficult challenges, and the wrong skin color, if I just survive, I'm going to be happy. And so we resign to live a life of mediocrity. Hey, that is another viral attack. It's got a serious viral attack. What do? You rise up, consider the scripture, consider the promises of God, and you are going to be convinced. Like Abraham, fully persuaded. You're going to rise up and say, man, I'm more than a conqueror through him. And his favor surround me as with a shield. And you're going to rise up and focus on his promise and say, hey, the step of a good man is ordered by the light. The path of the righteous is shining, getting brighter, brighter until the break of dawn. None of it, you consider the scripture instead of consider the condition around about you. Perhaps you hear the medical report, the doctor say, man, you have this chronic disease. You've got to live with it for the rest of your life. You can survive. And instead of considering God and his promises, you Google search for 66 hours or 666 hours and considering, well, the chances of it doesn't get this particular chronic condition, whether it's going to survive, you find out that, hey, man, on the average, it's only 4 months. You got very troubled, very anxious, you call out your friend says, hey, man, my uncle got this disease, he kicked the bucket in 3 months. You're filled with all kind of anxiety, All right, it's because we consider the circumstances. The point is, I'm not saying that you deny reality. I'm saying you get the best medical treatment, but our focus, our mind, heart must be single-minded on the promises of God. God says, you will live and not die, declare the goodness of God. God says, the number of my days God will fulfill. God says, with long life, he will satisfy you and show you Yahshua. And other people say, amen. All right? You're not denying reality. The thing is that you don't want to focus on the problem, because when you focus on the problem, that problem becomes magnified. You focus on the promises of God, God becomes magnified, faith is going to arise. You're going to be fully persuaded with what God has promised. Oh, Pastor, I'm very concerned for my kid that have gone off course. Instead of considering the problem and the situation, it may be real, but our focus is on the promises of God. And we're going to give thanks and rise up fully persuaded. Lord, I thank you that kids may have gone off course, but they're going to come back, because me and my house shall serve the Lord. The seeds of the righteous shall be mighty in the land. You know what you're doing? You are considering the promises of God, not the problem. Oh, Pastor, I will never be able to break free from this addiction. I will never be able to come out of the debt that I'm having right now. That is another viral attack. You got to be alert. All right, don't bathe in self-pity. Oh, yeah, Lord, I'm like that, Lord. I cannot overcome, Lord. No, he rises up, but God says, I'm a new creation. I have new gene. Say to the person, right, you have a new DNA. You're a God's child, and Hamramas know that God's new gene in you is stronger than your old gene. And other people say, amen. Oh, Pastor, I have too many adversaries. I have the people in the office, the people that are least expected. They're talking about me behind my back. Don't consider what they say. Don't dwell on it for 7 hours, call up and pick up the phone and call 7 hours, make a defense of yourself and setting the record straight. And they call angry, upset, and lose your faith, and your heart become polluted and infected with a kind of a fatal viral. No, you rise up and say, amazing, astounding promise going to give us that he has armed me with strength for better, and no weapon formed against me shall prosper, for this is the heritage of the servant of the Lord. And you hold me in the palm of your hand. My life is in your hand. And man, you're going to be fully persuaded what God has promised you, in other people say. One time, Brother Dindagaran was having a very chronic disease, and he prayed for many people. People got healed of cancer, paralysis, demonic people were being delivered. He has an amazing, tremendous, miraculous ministry. But he was suffering from a chronic disease, and he cried to God, God, why? And God said to him, remember the letter that you received. Yeah, Lord, that letter that I received from my critic, and it's so hurting. And that's the problem. You read the letter twice. What happened was, Brother Dindagaran was considering the words of the people, instead of the words of God. The thing is, that is a viral attack. All right, there's nothing wrong with your hardware. It is a software that has been infected, and you got to get rid of it with the word of God. The thought comes, oh, Pastor, I don't have the strength. I don't think I'm going to be able to fulfill the quota. I don't think I'm going to be able to do this examination. I don't think I'm going to be able to fulfill the requirement to finish off that dissertation or thesis. That is another viral attack. Recognize it. Because focus and consider the scriptures. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. I'm equal to anything, ready for anything, through him who infuses inner strength unto me. And he who has begun a good work in me, he will bring it to completion. And other people say, amen. Oh, Pastor, it's too late. I don't think I'm going to have a great life. I make too many mistakes. God says, I will restore the years. Do you know that is an astounding word? God actually can restore your years. In other words, what does that mean? He can reverse time. He can reverse lost opportunity. Remember the story of King Hezekiah? One day he was stricken with a chronic disease. Isaiah the prophet came along and said, oh, king, you have finished. Set your house in order. And the prophet came by that man. But Hezekiah didn't give up. Hezekiah, the Bible tells us, cried to God. And you know what? Just about when Isaiah was able to reach the doorpost of the house, God said, U-turn. So he U-turned and he gave a word to King Hezekiah and said, God has given you your request. You will have many, many more years. And King said, okay, this is a sign, proof that God has answered my prayer. God said, the sun, the shadow in the sun dial will reverse certain number of steps. Do you know that's amazing? You know, sundial is a clock. That means God says he's going to reverse the clock. God, how many of us know, is so big. So you talk about Hollywood, what's called Back to the Future, that is a fantasy, but in God's heart, there's no fantasy. God can restore the time that you have lost, and other people say, including lost opportunity. So how about it's too late? That is a viral attack. There's, how many of us know, never too late to have a fresh new start. And other people say, amen. The greatest day of your life is just right ahead of you. If you don't give up. Oh, Pastor, I'm in a big mess. Really big mess. God says, I will give you beauty for ashes. How many of us know there could be no more messier situation than having ashes run about your house? A little bit of wind, it blows all over the place. But God says he can give you beauty for ashes. That's astounding. Oh, Pastor, I made too many mistakes. I don't think I'm going to be able to be a good father. I don't think I'm going to be a good spouse. I don't think I'm going to be a good businessman. I make too many bad choices. I don't think I'm going to have a healthy body. I make too many mistakes. Hey, that is another viral attack. You're going to rise up tall and say, God's mercy, I knew every morning, great is your faithfulness, and other people say. Learn from your mistakes. Don't deny it. Don't give excuses. Deal with it and move on. And other people say, amen. Oh, Pastor, I'm so ugly. I'm too short. I'm too dark. I'm too fair. My voice is too high. And no. So considering what you see in the natural, consider what God said. God said you are wonderfully made. God said you are unique in his eye. God said you have the right gift, talents that are designed for you. God said, above all, you're a masterpiece. Like Mona Lisa, I remember there's no another original copy of the Mona Lisa. This is the one masterpiece. The same way God look at you and say, hey man, you're a masterpiece. Set up on the right, you may look like it, you may not look like it, but you are a real masterpiece. And other people say, amen. When I say, oh, Pastor, I wish I could somebody else's talent. I wish I could somebody's gifting. That is a viral attack. You realize that God has made you the way you are, and God's eye, you are a masterpiece. Other people say, oh, Pastor, nobody loves me. That's another viral attack. That is a lie, because the Bible tells us he has redeemed us with the precious blood of Christ. How valuable is the blood of Christ? Immensely, infinitely valuable. That's how valuable you are. So you got to consider what God says. Now, how many of us know when you consider what God says, you actually activate angelic forces being released to act on your behalf? Because the Bible tells us in Psalm 103, verse 20,
bless the Lord, you his angels, who excel in strength, who do his word, heeding the voice of his word.
Now remember that we have guardian angels. Some people say on the right and the left, all right? And some people have more perhaps. How to get your angels that encamp around about you to act on your behalf? The answer is here, it says here, do his word, heeding the voice of his word. How to get angels activate? You don't get your angels activated by talking to angels. You're not supposed to talk to your angels. Right? You know, there's some places where you actually pray to the saints. No, we don't do that. We don't talk to angels. All we need to do is speak God's word. Speak God's promises, and they are programmed, put it this way, all right, to respond as you speak God's word. And other people say, amen. You know, perhaps in the time where you're filled with all kinds of fear and a very frightening situation, all right, and then say, oh man, it is finished, it's gone. No. You lay hold of the scripture to say, as in Psalm 91, that he gives his angels charge over you and bear you up, and not one bone will be broken. When you proclaim that, it's God's word. The angels, wrong about you, have no choice but to just obey. Not obey you. It's not about you. It's about the word of God that you proclaim. The angels are programmed to act. And you can imagine all those angels flying around like those F-16 planes going around there, protecting Air Force One. Same way, when you speak His word, you can imagine those angels flying around, shoom, 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 fulfilling what you have asked Him to do. And other people say, amen. But the problem, many of us have a wrong picture of angels. Typically, we have a picture of angels like those Hollywood describe. Chubby little baby with the wings at the back, floating around, nice, very nice, cute, but useless. I remember, in the Bible, angels are incredibly powerful. The Bible says, in one occasion in the Bible, one angel finishes off 185,000 enemy soldiers. That is how powerful angels are. But you know, despite the fact that they're so powerful, they are immensely gentle. Like God, they're a perfect gentle. They will not come and force Himself into your life if you don't invite Him. In other words, He will just stand there. But you got to invite them to act on your behalf as you speak God's word. Because humbleness, though, just like God, He respects you. He's the creator of the universe, but He's a perfect gentleman. He waits for you to speak His word. On the other hand, you speak negative. Man, you're finished with me. I'm gone. I make too many mistakes. And speak negative. You know, humbleness, though, when you speak negative, demonic forces are released to act for you. Or rather, put this way, against you. The thing is, when you speak God's word, angelic forces are released to encamp round about you. Look at the passage in Psalm 34, verse 7.
The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear Him, and He delivers them.
So, maybe you are presenting a proposal to an important client, and the deal is $500 billion. So, oh man, I don't have what to take, I don't have the connection, I don't have this, I don't have that. You're tying the hand of your angels, but you rise up and say, man, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. His favor surround me as with a shield. The path of the righteous is getting brighter and brighter until the break of dawn. I'm going to get a best day ahead of me. Wow! The angels say, what are we waiting for? Michael, let's go on, because He's spoken God's word. We have to obey immediately. And other people say, I heard the story of this young lady that was in the deserted car park, and there was this three huge men coming about to assault her, and suddenly they ran. A few months later, these three people were caught and in an identification period, and the lady was being asked to be there, and out of curiosity asked one of the men, why did you run away from me that day? I'm just alone. And they said, are you kidding? You're not alone. And there's one guy standing next to you. He's 10 foot tall with muscle bulging, face radiating with a sword drawn in his hand, as if saying to me, you try, do anything, make my day. Yeah. I remember, so this is a manifestation of angels, because in the quietness of the heart, says, oh man, it's finished, man, it's gone. I hope they make the right coffin for me and the right place for me. No, she rose up tall. She confessed that He gives His angels charge over me, not one bone shall be broken. He takes His angels to take charge of me. And man, humble mercy, though, God's word activates amazing forces to act on your behalf. So number one, your heart must be single-hearted upon the promises of God. Number two, let your heart be single-minded on His greatness, letting God arise. Look at Psalm 68, verse 1.
Let God arise, let His enemies be scattered.
Now what do you mean by the phrase, let God arise? God's always high up. You don't have to ask Him to rise up high. He's already there. He's up there. He's infinitely high. But what does it mean, let God arise? It really means let God rise up high in our eyes. Let God be big in our eyes. Why do you think that we got to see God big? Because when you see God big, the problem that you're facing becomes small. Begin to realize that your God is so immensely big. He spoke and the world came into being. He flung the stars into its orbits. That is how big your God is. But it's so loving. He holds you in the palm of his hand. Remember the story of the 12 spies being sent to survey the land? 10 came back and said, "Oh man, we cannot take the land because the land is filled with giants. We are but grasshopper." What was the problem with the 10? They see the giants so big because their God is so small. But the 10 of them came back with a negative report. None of them entered the promised land. In other words, you cannot talk negative, achieve great destiny. No way. But two of them came back and say, "Well, don't worry, we are well able to take the land. Those giants that you see are just but chapati for us, bread for us." Now, does it mean that these two people are denying reality? But these two are not just focusing on reality, these two are focusing on the truth. And the truth is that your problem may be big, but your God is almighty. And other people say, your problem, no matter how big, not denying the greatness of your problem, no matter how big your problem is no match to your God. And other people say, amen. Wonderful Jesus. And God says that the greatest force, Abramus though, are breathing in your direction. I mean, you get to see him, how big that he is. I mean, look at Joshua. Jesus, God, actually stopped the moving of the sun just to keep, remember, Joshua asked God to lengthen the day, and God lengthened the day. Abramus would take immense force to hold back the sun. A little tsunami, just tilted the earth just a little second, and that is so much power. And can you imagine how many tsunami power needed to just hold the sun for the couple of hours? That's what God did for Joshua, because God, your God, is immensely powerful. God stopped a lion that is attacking Daniel. God fed 5,000 with 22 loaves of fishes, 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread. That's the God that we worship. And remember the story of King Jehoshaphat? One day, this great king was surrounded with 3 huge armies. In the natural, is no match. What did King Jehoshaphat did? Did he complain and say, "Oh, poor me, I served God all my life, brought revival to the nation, and now I'm faced with all this enemy"? No, he didn't complain. The Bible tells us King Jehoshaphat focused on God. He prayed, "Oh God, all power is in your hand, and you rule the nation of the earth." And man, God gave King Jehoshaphat a tremendous victory. So with David, how did David fought Goliath? In the midst of the threats of Goliath, the army of Saul was hiding in caves. But David one day rose up with courage, looked at Goliath and said, "You come to me with a sword and javelin and helicopter gunship, but I come against you in the name of the Lord God Almighty, whom you defile today. Today I give you the best to eat." David has a big God. And other people say, amen. The people that focus on the problem, you're going to magnify the problem. People that focus on the problem say, "Well, man, Goliath is too big. I cannot overcome." David comes along with a big God and say, "Goliath is too big. I cannot miss him." And other people say, amen. Story of Gideon, right? It's very interesting because the context of the story of how God called Gideon, there was the people of God were being oppressed for 7 years. I mean, a feeling that you're being oppressed for 7 years or more. I remember, so it's one day too long. Today, your oppression is going to leave you, and other people say, how did the oppression leave Gideon? One day, the angel of the Lord, I believe, is a manifestation of Christ, a pre-incarnate Christ, came along and said, "Gideon, mighty man of fearless courage." Gideon looked around. What is he talking about? Huh? Ooh, yeah. Mighty man of fearless courage. And an angel of the Lord said, "Hey, you, I'm talking about you. Huh? Are you joking?" This is how Gideon replied in Judges chapter 6.
"But Lord," Gideon replied, "how can I rescue Israel? My clan is the weakest in the whole tribe of Manasseh, and I am the least in my entire family."
You know what Gideon said? "I'm the least in my clan. I'm the smallest in my family. How can I bring people out of oppression?" Verse 18.
"And Jehovah said to him, because I am with you, you shall strike Midian as one man.
What is important, God say to Gideon, is not how big you are, it's how big God is. And other people say, amen. I mean, you can understand how big your God is. Your this qualification is your qualification. And other people say, somebody had to have a mentality, oh, Pastor, if only I had the capital, if only I have the gifting, Pastor, if only I have the connection, if only I have the ability, like that guy, if only I have people like that office God. Hey, put it this way, just like Gideon, when God said to Gideon, it's not your size, it's his size, I am with you. You know, God is able to turn something incredibly small into something astoundingly big. Astounding. I mean, God turned a tiny little cloud. The prophet's servant looked up to the sky. It was just a tiny little cloud, the size of a man's fist. And with that tiny little cloud, God brought a storm that brought an end to 3.5 years of drought in the times of that King Ahab. How many must know? Your season of drought is over. Your season of dryness is over. And other people say, and you got to get ready for the rain of God's blessing going to pour down upon you, no matter how small you think you are. And other people say, and God can use the jawbone of a donkey. A donkey don't really amount to much, right? Donkey. Sometimes it's quite a nasty word, you're a donkey. And that means, you know. And God used the jawbone, dead bone. Dead, not just a donkey, not a live donkey, a dead donkey's jawbone. God placed it at the hand of a guy called Samson, 6:30 judge. And that 6:30 judge, with a jaw of a donkey, dead bone, finish off hundreds of enemy soldiers. God is able to take something very small in your imperfection and do great exploits. When your heart is focused right, you see your God is big, your enemy becomes small. Let God arise, his enemy is scattered. And other people say, amen. Amen. That's the goodness of God. He's a big God. Wonderful Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Don't listen to the never lies. How about those know that this never lie, I never amount to anything, I'll never be promoted, I will never be able to open my own business, I'll never be able to learn a new skill, I'm too old. Never too old to learn a new skill. I pick up my iPad from Pastor Kerry. It's always reminding me. Always learn this new skill, no matter how old or young you are. You can pick up a new skill. I think right now I'm quite good with my iPads, all right? The thing is, Hamra must know God is a good God. It's never too late to do anything. Pastor, I will never rise up high. I come from the wrong family. Pastor, I have no connection. That is another viral attack. Got to realize it. And you got to focus on what he has promised, that you are no ordinary being. You're a seed of Abraham. Man, you have all astounding bloodline. You are a child of the Most High God. You have seeds of greatness. And all the seeds of greatness, people say, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Wonderful Jesus. But kidding, you've got to be single-minded. Your heart must not be polluted with all kinds of mental viruses. Your focus, single-minded. Your heart must be upon, number one, the promises of God. You're going to be fully persuaded. Your faith is going to rise. And your focus must be on God's greatness. But most important of all, this is the last point, the most important point. Let your heart be single-minded on his goodness. And you know what? You will reign. Let me ask you the question. What is the overriding picture of God do you have? Sometimes we pick up pictures of God as we grew up. Maybe your mom and dad is a very stingy guy. Pastor, he's talking about my mom. 1 cent count. And because of that, the tendency for us to see God as stingy. But look at God's word, you see different. the first miracle that God performed when he was on earth, turning what? Six jars, huge jars. Man, the people got overdrunk with the sort of the best wine. That's God's standard. And he fed the 5,000. How many baskets left over? 12 baskets. Sometimes you get invited for dinner. Pastor, I know it's okay to eat, but make sure you don't order too much. Don't waste. That's not God's standard. Oh, Pastor, just arrange this catering. I have 500 guests, but I think I just ordered for 400 enough already. Just nice. Oh, no, that is not God's standard. God's standard is over and above until there are 12 baskets left over. What kind of a picture of God do you have? What kind of overriding picture of God do you have? Take a look at the book of Revelation. John, the apostle, had a dream or a vision. One day he got a vision, he saw a scroll with words written on the back and the front. And the elder spoke to John. No one is worthy to open up the scroll. Now, what is the scroll? I believe the scroll were written the destiny for you and me. But John, the Bible tells us, cried and cried and cried because no one was worthy to open up the scroll. And there was a tap on John's shoulder. He was crying. He was like so disappointed no one was worthy to open up the scroll. And when his elder tapped on his shoulder and said, there is one who is worthy, and he is the lion of the tribe of Judah. Let's pick up the story. Revelation 5, verse 5.
Then one of the elders said to me, do not weep. See, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has triumphed.
Amazing how Jesus Christ was being described. He is the root of David. We all know that Jesus Christ is the son of David. But the Bible put it in the proper perspective. He may be in the natural, the son of David, but actually he's the root of David. And other people say he is the source where David came from, and he is the lion of the tribe of Judah. See, the angel said to John, see. But what happened when he opened his eye? Nobody see. He saw the six.
Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne.
Wow. What did John saw? He didn't see a roaring lion. Right at the center of the throne, he saw a lamb that was slain. Let me ask you, what is the overriding picture of God do you have? Do you see him as a God of wrath? And it will be very true. The Bible tells us God is a God of wrath. But is that what God wants to be the center picture of your life? That is, the center of the throne was the Lamb. He may be a God of wrath, but that wrath is not his central character, put it this way. Wrath is more of a reaction against sin. But he is not the God of wrath that you think he is. He wants you to see him as the lamb that gave his life for your sin. That is the very center picture of God that God wants you to have. If you have any other center, you are going to live in all kinds of guilt and condemnation. You will not believe that you have what it takes to do great exploits. You'll always be filled with guilt and condemnation, a sense of unworthiness, but you're going to see the lamb, man, God in Christ, the lion of the tribe of Judah, did everything to bring us to him and give us the great exploits, and other people say, amen. Amen. Because when he was up on the cross, the Bible tells us he consumed, he exhausted every ounce of God's wrath against sin. Right now, God wants you to see him as angry with you. God wants you to come and see him as one who gave his life for you, loving you with a passion, and other people say. Same way, God is omnipotent, omniscient. In the article, I put down omnipresent. I mean, they're all theologically sound, and he's great. But let me ask you, what is the overriding picture that God wants you to have of Him. He wants you to see Him as the Lamb that loved you, that gave His life for you. Not to say He's not almighty, He is almighty, but the overriding picture that God wants to see of Him is a God who loves you with a passion. Same way, in a very small way, I'm Pastor Joshua. In case you don't know, I'm, to some, in the more formal setting, the Reverend Dr. Joshua Yi Kwong Kyo. The Zam is boss. But my children, they come straight to my office, help themselves to the refrigerator with all the chocolates and all the nuts that I have in my fridge. And sometimes they didn't even say, Dad, just come straight to my office. Because why? They are my children. I will be very worried one day. One of my kids come to me, the Reverend Dr. Joshua Yi, can I have, please, tuition fees? No, they come and say, Dad, where's the check? Of course, they're not like that, right? Again, he's, how am I going to get that kind of bonus? The Lamb of God to the very center of the throne of God. And other people say, affect your prayer. You don't have to pray, oh, omnipotent God, one God, world without end. And change your tone, change your intonation. You only do is simply say, Abba, Father, God. Some people when they pray, they have the word Lord, like a punctuation mark, Lord, 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 Lord. You can count hundreds of Lords when they pray. I can imagine if my kid addressed me that way, Daddy Lord, Daddy Boss, Dad says, Dad, just how God wants you to address. When you address Him right, how many know, you're going to see that you're going to do great exploits. And I'll be able to say, what happened when they address God that way? Look at verse 9.
And they sang a new song, you are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain. And with your blood, you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation.
Verse 10.
And have made us kings and priests to our God, and we shall reign on the earth.
When you have the right picture of God, the Lamb, because it's at the center of the throne, the center of the vision, you're going to reign as kings, as priests. Not only are you going to be in control of the situation, not the situation control you. You're going to be reigning over the weaknesses in your life because you are reigning as a priest. And other people say, amen. So these, God must be right at the center. The kind of a picture God wants us to have of Him is that He is a lamb. It's a roaring, not a roaring lion, it's a lion, a tribe of Judah, but it's a lamb that is slain for us. And other people say, let me ask this question. Why do you say grace? Suddenly we forgot to say, I better say, otherwise stomach ache. So we thought that saying grace mainly to keep yourself from germs, you're going to get virus. Oh, your stomach ache because I didn't say grace. Now, why do you say grace? Let me tell you, isn't this not to get rid of the poison? Of course, it will. God's protection is going to be upon you. But you say grace because you acknowledge Him and His goodness. You give thanks to Him that you have the money, you have the health to enjoy the food that is lavished before us. And other people say, the more you focus on His grace, the more grace it could be multiplied in your. And it's not just about saying grace at the table, the early morning. All right, Lord, I thank you for this day. I can walk. Many people can't even walk. Take a look, there's a roof over my head. You may be living in a one-room flat, but you feel like you're the richest man because you're at peace with your family members. Thank God that I have a roof over my head. Acknowledge His goodness. And man, you're going to see outstanding breakthrough in your life. And your drivers that are complaining, oh man, I have this 20-year, 9-month car. Thank God for the car. At least you don't ride on the bicycle. At least you have a lick. And all the people say, oh, so this road, there's always traffic jam. Thank God, because at least you have road. Some places, no road. Some places have road, but a bomb, flat, no more roads because of the bomb. All right? For everything. and you're going to focus on His goodness, you'll see that you're going to reign as king, reigning as priest. And other people say, in closing, back to the story of King Jehoshaphat. I started off, I didn't end. I'm going to end with King Jehoshaphat's story. And it's sounding, when King Jehoshaphat heard about the three armies that encircle him, he started off with focusing on the greatness of God, the greatness of God. That's what I did. All right, I'll show you how it must be single-hearted, focus on the promises of God, focus on the greatness of God. King Jehoshaphat started off with the greatness of God, but he didn't end there. Greatness of God, knowing God is great, is good, is omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. This is important. We need to know Him as big, but more than that, beyond that, King Jehoshaphat, the Bible tells, sent his choir ahead of the army. What does that mean? You can plan, you can make plan, you can do everything you can. Like you have a medical condition, get a medical best medical treatment, do everything you can, send the army down, strategize. But ahead of the strategy, ahead of what you do, what you felt is the best thing in your business, ahead of this, send the choir down. What did the choir sing? Take a look at a passage in 2 Chronicles.
When he had consulted with the people, he appointed those who sang to the Lord and those who praised him in holy attire. As they went out before the army and said, "Give thanks to the Lord, for his loving kindness is everlasting."
Ahead of the armies, ahead of the human strategy, the best you can do in the natural, send your choir down. And what did they sing? They gave thanks to the Lord because his loving kindness is everlasting. Jehoshaphat's focus is on the goodness of God. And how many people say, you know what happened? It took 3 days for King Jehoshaphat to collect all the gold and all the silver and all the spoils of war that were left behind by the invading army, because God caused the army to fight one another, the three of them, and left behind all these things. Hey, friend, great exploits are destined for you when your heart is single-minded on His promise, on His greatness, and on His goodness. And not just your song, even your testimony. When you give your testimony, it's important. Don't focus on what you did. Because when you focus on what you did, there's not going to be breakthrough. There are not going to be 3 days of spoils. But when you focus on what God did for you, what Christ did for you, the love of God in your life, boom, 3 days to collect your spoils. And how many of you say amen to that? Shall we all stand as we come to the Lord's table? Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Doesn't mean that you're going to be perfect. It simply means your heart is focused. Single-mindedly, number one, are the promises of God. That's what Jehoshaphat did. Lay hold of God's promises. Lay hold of God's greatness. That's what Jehoshaphat did. You, oh God, controls everything. He holds every people under your control. That's Jehoshaphat prayed. But above all, Jehoshaphat sent the choir down, the head of the army, and they sang the loving kindness and the goodness of God. Let it be the song that we sing. Let it be the testimony that we write. Focusing not what we did, because if we focus on what we did, we get a pat on the back of the people that listen to you. So all that you got is pity. But you want pity? You want 3 days of the spoils of war, and other people say. You want great exploits. And the key to the great exploits is to focus on His goodness. We'd like to close, give an opportunity for those of you who have not known Jesus Christ to be Lord of your life, to say this prayer. Would you join together with me to receive Christ into your life? Say together with me, "Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die for me on the cross. Right now, I receive Him as my Lord and Savior." In Jesus' name, and all of you will scream. There is
no fear. If you have said that prayer and want to know more or have any feedbacks, please write to us.
be here.